mine's very nice. I don't give login passwords.
My state agency requires me to.
Well, it is a federal requirement, but we don't. We work our way around that so that we don't.
Help us out on that. How do you work your way around that one?
Our IT guy had a baby the week they were there this time. We have the little netbooks that they carry into the rooms and download their information from there, and it goes straight into the abaqis. And the only problem with that sometimes is actually getting the netbook to be fast enough. Mm-hmm. That's the biggest problem that we've had going into the rooms rather than being out in the hallway. We've had some issues with the computers being a little slow. So
one of the things that we found is that a couple of our buildings have 11 to 7 front desk personnel on. It's very easy to train them on how to do yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, and then type in, you know, resident comments. So it shouldn't take, one of the things I guess, you know, I'm looking at now in general is, we dumped a lot of stuff on nursing, and, if we can make it time efficient for the nurse to do, or time efficient for whoever the interviewer is, and if you have somebody sitting on a desk on 3 to 11 or 11 to 7, God love them, they can click those buttons for you. And it doesn't take long to put an interview in. It takes, a minute and a half, if that long, if you're slow. So we're not talking this huge amount of time for stuff. One of the questions somebody had in one of the two sessions, and they didn't differentiate it, was, do I need a 0.5 FTE for this? I think if you're doing existing quality program, you don't need any extra folks. I don't know what you guys think on that one, but.
No, for us, no additional personnel. We added no one.
We didn't either.
Just you have to be realistic at this. If you're interviewing residents, it's not the keystroking is easy, whether you do it on paper first and then do it, but it can take time. That's all.
Absolutely.
So it just has to be integrated in what you currently do. And I mean, some of your suggestions about care planning and how do you take this and really make it a day-to-day thing is some of the good points that I'm walking away from this.
Question.
Hi, good morning. We're a provider in California, so we're looking at possibly a year, maybe two or three, considering our budget problems in California. we don't have a budget.
No, exactly.
So the question is, would the abaqis and the QIS preparation process benefit us in preparing for a traditional survey? And conversely, are there anything that this changes the focus on that would leave us potentially open to that we'd have to, provide some additional coverage to make sure that we're fully prepared? Mm-hmm. If you could comment on that.
I don't think that you would be left vulnerable, because even when you look at QIS, in the traditional survey, what I found, and we've talked about somewhat, is a surveyor would come in with a penchant for whatever it is, infection control, wounds, whatever. But with QIS and with abaqis, I have to say, maybe mimicking QIS or following the same structure and process, then you're covering all the regulatory groupings. You're not leaving out anything under the QIS using abaqis. You're gonna cover every regulatory grouping. So it doesn't matter whether you're a traditional survey or a QIS survey, you're covering all the areas that you need to cover as far as regulations.
I also think, since we're in traditional surveys this year, some of the processes that the surveyors in New York have been using have been taking really what is Missouri in their toolbox, if you would, from CMS, because that's where they get trained. They use the critical element pathways when they move into their stage two. It's just, you don't quite know that they're in, stage two per se, because it's, it's a traditional survey and they might kind of start there with some things. But the tools and the things that you use, and they're using them more and more even in the traditional survey. I see the surveyors from the kinds of questions, I could see that they're using a critical element pathway that you get access to as, part of the training.
Same F tags, same surveyor guidance, no matter if you're in traditional or QIS survey. And, if California or you guys are like some of the other states, we used to have this phone tree. Oh God, your team's on advanced directives when they come in, or they're looking at, falls this time. Make sure you have all your falls, because that's all they're going to look at is falls. You know, the word gets out. Certainly that does help, but the one thing with abaqis is that you have a critical amount pathway for falls. You have one for labs. You have a way to work through this logically so that then you can look at your root cause analysis and you can find out, you know, what it really is versus what we think it is and throw a form at it. We're good in long-term care about developing forms, I can guarantee you that. And we probably have these little audit tools flying around. When you put them all together, it's a lot more paper than a stage two critical element pathway that you can use for lots of different things. And so, long response to the answer is, sure, I would, we did it. I mean, we had both during your transition in California. Right. You're gonna find that, you know, your survey team arrived and you're like, is it QIS or traditional? And then you're gonna be there like traditional and you're like, ugh, you know? Because you really, once you start moving on the QIS and get in that mindset, I think you'll find it's a more robust survey process. It opens you up to, in Maryland, it opens lots of people up to a lot of deficiencies they've never heard of, some F tags that have been hanging out there for years that Maryland never cited, because it wasn't their focus. They were a medical model, and that's sort of where they hung their hat. So a lot of this other stuff starting to creep up as far as these strange F tags occurring, and people are going, oh my God, I didn't even know that was an F tag. So that's hanging out there. Any other questions?
Thanks very much for sharing. Your information helps a lot. My question is about mock survey. You mentioned that you do them. I'm curious how, under abaqis, your mock survey system within your organization changed, and I'm also curious as to, with multi-facility organizations, how your regional or corporate office staff participate in the process.
You guys want to?
Well, I have the three buildings, and of course with abaqis, I have access to each of their information. And what we do is, when I go on and look, we check to see, make sure everything is current, make sure they've uploaded their data timely, and when things are like over the threshold, I simply just try to ensure that they have worked through each of the items that are red flagging and that they put that information into their QA. It doesn't matter how minor it is, how far down on the pole it is. If it's not in the, if it's in the red, actually on the abaqis, you should have it in your QA and you should work it just as full-fledged as you would if it were 100% over the threshold.
Yeah.